All right, so today I'm going to be going over the layout capabilities of Flux and what features you can use to be successful here. The first thing I want to go over is how schematic and PCB are linked. What you see is what you get on both sides. So they're completely live. There's no need to submit an engineering change request. That way you always trust what you can see. With that out of the way, the main interaction you use in Flux for connecting components together is routing. So use this for previous example. At a very basic level, you click a routing touch point and you can connect to these traces. And as you can see, I can toggle between the trace widths. There's many ways to constrain a trace width. You can edit it in its property directly. You could target it with rules, or there's other properties like preferred trace widths that you can apply to specific net containers to change which ones you would like to toggle through. So right there is a 40 mil trace. Let's say I want to go higher. And let's do that again. Also, let's flip this component. So as you can see, now we have a really big trace. And if I want to move to the top layer, I can right click and drop vias like so. All right, that's a simple routing. Let's say you want to route impedance match pairs. So in Flux, you can do so by specifying your target impedance in the part itself. Over here, it's a USB-C connector, and I want it to have a 90 ohm target impedance. So I'll specify that. And Flux will take this into account with your stackup and generate the right constraints to get you to that 90 ohm impedance. So let's finish that connection and go into stackup, because I'll show you how you can change that. So over here is the stackup editor. You can choose between a bunch of drop-down options, but you can also click this edit button to change the properties yourself to exactly what your manufacturer specifies. So you can add layers, you can add dielectrics, you can change their constants and their thicknesses, as well as change your drill hole processes. Let's say you have laser drills, for example. You could do that all in the stackup editor. When you first open Flux, you might see something like this. This big red piece of copper. You can toggle their visibility like so. And by default, they're connected to the ground layer. If you add a ground symbol, your fills will automatically connect to ground for you. If you can change the net that they're connected to, as you can see, this is ground. I've gone ahead and connected mid layer 2 to power 0, this simple trace here. As you can see, it's shorted to that trace, but none of the other traces. And you can do that by configuring some properties on the net. Let's say go to the power 0 net, and I've just changed the connected layers property to mid layer 2. That's how I specify mid layer 2 to be a power 0 net. You can do this for your power rails, and it just helps you form a very rudimentary power delivery network. Speaking of power delivery networks, at Flux, we believe in being declarative. So one of the problems with just drawing polygons or just having these dumb pieces of copper is that, you know, if you have many vias or obstacles that violate some sort of minimum trace width, or you want to hit a target impedance, it's very hard to know that. So at Flux, we believe in being declarative in our design. And one of the features we're working on right now is we're calling it spills. And what that looks like is a trace that respects the keep out of other traces. So instead of drawing a big piece of copper, here you're declaring connections between parts, between pads. And this creates a more intelligent power delivery network. Now we have the ability to define current constraints, resistance targets. Okay, so for component placement in Flux, you can find all your parts in the library, anything you have access to, just drag and drop. Okay, so in the PCB editor, you can drag components around to position them. If you want to align them, you can use these alignment markers that show up, which show up between pads, just like that. And you can get things really nicely aligned in grids. Let's say you have a bunch of components you want to space evenly. This is another feature we support, alignment and space evenly. So let's say I have this row of connectors. Everything on the outside, these are my anchors. I can click on space evenly horizontally. So now these are all spaced evenly. And let's say I want to align them. You could just say align them by their bottoms. Sure. And everything's aligned. So another thing I want to bring up is modules. Here I've dragged in a few. Let's just drag in another one. These behave, to Flux, these behave very similarly to components. But to the designer, what it is, it's an encapsulated design that you've already created. So if we click on it, this is a reference design from MPS. And all the layout is done, all the connections are made. And once you're done, you publish it to the library. And here, you can drag the whole thing around without messing up the connection. You can rotate it like you can with components. And you can even flip it. And it'll change the top components to the bottom layer, maintain the traces and all the connections. And this is a good way to reuse work across projects, as well as like maintain kind of heritage with your designs. You know that nothing's going to change when you use it across projects. Setting topic, how can AI help augment your layout capabilities? I'd say the very first thing I can think of is sifting through data sheets for you to give your designer the information they need quickly. Copilot can help lower the barrier to access that information. So here's a buck converter. It's a pretty simple one. And I asked Copilot to look through the data sheet to find any layout guidelines I might need to know of. To do that, you just click on librarian here, and that signals to Copilot that I should look through the data sheet. The best thing about this is that Copilot isn't making anything up. It'll go through a data sheet and summarize things like, oh, keep the switching node small. And that's pretty obvious, but Copilot here has linked a reference to where in the data sheet you can find that information. It just saves you the time of having to, you know, look through an unfamiliar data sheet and dig out that information. So the next way Copilot can help is with its general knowledge. So right here, I've gone ahead and made an example of some poorly laid out capacitors next to my controller. And I sent it an image and it's like, how can you improve this layout? So Copilot, the first thing it says is, oh, position the capacitors as close as possible, of course. You want to minimize loop area. Also place the 10 nanofarad capacitor before the 1 microfarad one. This is good to minimize your inductance. It's also saying things like, have a low impedance path to ground with your vias. So this is all like general good practices in electrical engineering. And this can help save a lot of time if you have a lot of these back and forth between the electrical engineer and your layout designer. Copilot can help smooth out a lot of the general cases and really help you value that time between them, the collaborative time. You focus on the more specific issues. And I just want to highlight another way you can use Copilot. I had this project where I wasn't sure the package, so I went and I measured it. And I gave the dimensions to Copilot and was like, hey, does this sound right? These are the measurements of my footprint. Does that sound right for this size resistor? And it could reason to a certain degree that, yeah, they're very close. You know, they're not exactly there, 7.2 to 6.35, but, you know, sounds right. So Copilot can help you if you give it some more context by feeding it some context or taking pictures of your design. Copilot can pull from a big wealth of knowledge and help you out on the fly. So next thing I want to go over is the property-based nature of Flux and how you can leverage that. Here's a very simple case. Let's say you change your manufacturing process and you can make your vias a bit smaller. You might have noticed we have this rules tab in Flux, and you can create rules that target your elements on your PCB by selectors. So this selector criteria, the simplest case, I just like all vias. And in this scenario, let's say we can go to 0.2 millimeter holes. As I change that, as you can see, all the vias in my project will get updated with this new property. And this change will persist when I drop new vias because they're selected by this rule. Now, you can get creative with these rules. You can select traces, pads, you can select them by the certain properties they have, by their designators. And this just allows you to be more declarative in your design instead of selecting something at once and changing it to just be perfect in that one time. you can declare that you want your entire design to behave a certain way in Flux. Finally, let's talk about locking. Let's say you have a finished design. You want to make sure you don't mess it up. So in Flux, we let you lock components and, you know, I put a lock on it. Now I can't edit it anymore. So let's say you have a layout you like, that's safe once you've locked it up. And the last thing is DRCs. So all your problems will show up down here in the problems drawer. And I just place this module here to generate some problems. So you can see we have some overlapping traces. So clicking on them will bring you to those traces, to the problem, and you can go fix that.
So one feature we recently introduced is measurements, and how you use it is you just select two traces or two objects that you want to measure the distance between. So in this case, I'm measuring the edge-to-edge distance between these traces. Measurement supports center-to-center and center edge-to-edge. So if you click on one object and go hover over the other one close to its edge, it'll tell you that the edge-to-edge spacing is 0.54 millimeters right here. And if you hover over the center, then you can see the pitch between these two components. This is really useful for traces on the fly. If there's something you didn't constrain all the way, just want to move quickly, you can just click on, you can just scan through your document, your project, and see what the spacing is. There are some cases where this becomes really useful when you're positioning a bunch of vias. Over here, as you can see, the spacing, the edge-to-edge spacing is 0.246 millimeters. I usually keep it above 0.2 millimeters. It depends on your manufacturer, but that's just like a rule of thumb I go by. And as well as like via to trace edge-to-edge spacing. Although you would ideally have these in your DRCs, it's really hard to design design a project and constantly be failing a DRC or waiting for the DRC to spawn. So on top of live DRCs, you can really instantly get that measurement feedback. So you could tweak your design on the fly, because you as a designer ultimately know more than your system does and can react faster to it.